Oh, yeah.
So we are going to have our third lecture on inflation now by Marco.
Hello, you can hear me, yes? Good afternoon. So my name is Marco Peloso. I'm working at Padova, here, nearby. And I would like to thank the organizers for this very nice school and for inviting me. And you know, I was here some 20 years ago as a student. I learned inflation from Andrew Liddell. And I'm honored and very happy to be here. And maybe in 20 years, some of you will be explaining the subject. So I work in inflation and reheating, which is the particle production after inflation. And also I worked in particle production during inflation. So this will be somehow put in my lectures. Although the first lecture is going to be very pedagogical, introductive, and then maybe we will discuss slightly more advanced material as time goes on. And this will be a board presentation. So essentially, that's the outline of the lectures. There will be inflation, which is motivations. That's where we're going to start. A simplest realization, very simple. And I will try to insist on primordial perturbations. Which is the way we try to test inflation. And then I'll discuss about production, particle production. After inflation. So this is what gets the name of reheating. And then I'll get production during inflation. And just to get some signatures, which would be, for example, some modified spectrum of perturbations. This is going to be my notation for perturbations, maybe primordial black holes, or maybe gravitational waves. You can try to get these within a context of inflation. And feel free to interrupt me whenever you want. No problem. I'll be happy to answer questions. So let me raise. So I'm going to say something very quickly that was already said this morning. So this is the expansion in standard cosmology. So distances essentially are proportional to a function of time that we call the scale factor. And then we define the Abel rate as the logarithmic derivative, where this means a derivative with respect to time. So these are the two mathematical quantities that we are going to deal with. And you can have a different type of domination. Matter or radiation. This will give an expansion that is a scale factor goes as time to the half. And if you do h, 1 over 2t. And this will give a scale factor a to the 2/3. And h is 2 over 3 time. That's what we would call a standard cosmology, in a sense, just a mixture of matter and radiation. Now, if this is obvious to you, OK, good. If it's not obvious, I have prepared a small homework. This will be homework 1.1. I'm going to put them on Slack. I prepare a set of guided homeworks. So if the statement, because I'm not going to prove all statements I make, right? So if the statement is obvious to you, Okay, end of the story. Otherwise, please have a look on Slack. I'll try to post something at the end of the lecture. Please. Yes, I have my notes. I will post them on Slack as well. If I, well, they, I should be able to clean them well enough. I'll try. Okay. Okay. So, having said like this, right, doesn't seem that there is any problem related to that. However, Guter realized that already this makes some problems, which is pretty remarkable. And I'm going to discuss to you, with you, first of all, the horizon problem. So I'm trying to essentially discuss why people do inflation, essentially, why the standard expansion that I was telling you so far has some problems, let's say. And I will try to skip most of the math and try to just make some qualitative, semi-qualitative arguments. And let me just define the horizon to be the region in causal connection. And the horizon is just expanding with the speed of light. Again, I will try to minimize the calculation. So some horizon size, which is just c times t. And you can see, right, now I'm going to set, this is the last time, probably I'm going to write c. Then I'm going to use c is equal 1, as we already discussed this morning. And so neglecting order 1 factors, we see that this is essentially 1 over h. So 1 over h gives us the measure of the horizon. And the problem, although it's not obvious why it's a problem, but the problem is that the horizon grows faster than physical scales. You see, the horizon grows as one as t. The physical scale grows lower, either as t to the 1/2 or t to the 2/3. So why is it a problem? Well, let's look at the sky we see today. Which is our horizon. And then let's scale. Imagine you take the physical sphere, right? That is the size you see today, and go back to earlier times. This is the same region. So this is the same physical region at earlier times. And this is the size is proportional to the scale factor, which is either t to the 2/3 or t to the 1/2. This is the horizon today, the physical region scaled back in the past. On the other hand, we know that the horizon, if you play the movie backwards, shrinks faster. So this will be the size of the horizon at that time. And here, we immediately see that there is an issue, right? Because essentially, what I'm telling you is that the sky that we see today was made of regions that in the past didn't have time to talk to each other. And that's essentially would be our predictions, for example, for the CMB that was emitted in the past. The sky that I observe at the time of CMB emission should have made of many regions which were not in causal connection one with the other. And you can even ask, and this will be homework 1.2, you can ask what is the size at a CMB emission. And if you just take our sky, this is about 2 degrees. So if you're here, right, this is the last scattering surface, right, the one that this is essentially CMB emission. And since we know when CMB was emitted, we can play this movie backwards. And in the homework, I will be quantitative, and you will are guided to do this. And you can check that the size is, the coherence size is 2 degrees. What it means that according to this picture, if I have an observation of two places which are farther apart than 2 degrees, they didn't have time to talk to each other. They shouldn't have the same temperature. Of course, this is completely in contrast with what we observe. Because we observe the same t everywhere. So this is the horizon problem, right? Why do we get the same temperature from everywhere when in standard cosmology, these regions were not connected to each other? And The problem mathematically arises because this dh over a increases. And what is it, right? dh over a is t over a. So this is 1 over h a. Remember, t is 1 over h. And remember, what is h? A dot over a. So this is 1 over a dot. So the problem is that 1 over a dot increases. So the problem is because a dot decreases. So the problem is because decelerated expansion. Pretty remarkable, right? If I was just saying to you, there is a problem because the expansion is decelerated, it would be a really non-trivial statement. But hopefully, right, by looking at this argument, we understand why there is a problem. The fact that the universe is decelerating creates this problem. Questions? Okay. So let me move to a different problem, which is completely unrelated. And what is amazing is that it is caused by the same thing. So here we saw a problem that is due to the fact that this conventional source leads to decelerated expansion. And now we'll show you another problem, which originates from the same fact, which is the flatness problem. So the evolution of a scale factor is the Freeman law, the one we already saw today, with the curvature term added. Okay, so some notation. This suffix 0 means today. And also, I have normalized the scale factor to be 1 today. So you see, when I play the movie backwards, right, the radiation energy density grows as 1 over a to the 4. If a is much smaller than 1 in the past, this was bigger. This is 1 over volume. Instead, you see that the curvature term is 1 over a squared. And as we saw today, the curvature term needs to be smaller than 0.4% today. But then if you think a moment, it's pretty remarkable, right? Because this term is the one that is less affected by the expansion of the universe. Imagine that at some point in the past they were equal to each other. Then this should be the dominant one, because this decreases at 1 over a to the 4. This decreases 1 over a to the cube. This decreases 1 over a squared. And in fact, it's the one that is very small. Why is it so small? If you think about, if you have this constraint, this should have been smaller than 10 to the minus 18 when universe was 1 second old. And of course, even much, much smaller when the universe was younger. Of course, you could tell me, OK, I know the universe is flat. If I know the universe is flat, this term is absent, period. That's a solution. But if instead you think that the universe is closed or open, maybe you think the universe was nucleated as closed, so that it has a final volume, then you really need to understand why this term is so small. And again, I can try to understand to connect to the previous problem, why there is a problem, essentially. The problem arises because the standard sources scale as a to the minus P with P greater than 2. Right, for matter P is equal 3, for radiation P is equal 4. But in general, the problem is that this is a 2, right? If I have something here that this decreases faster than a to the minus 2, then there is this problem. Now, let's just imagine that there is this dominant term, right? So if I just look at the equation there, I'll have a dot square divided by a square proportional one or proportional to a to the minus p. So just from that term. Which implies that a dot square is proportional to the a to the 2 minus p. But since p is greater than 2, this decreases. Again, there is a problem because the standard sources lead to decelerated expansion. Now, if you look at textbooks, now there are textbooks on inflation or reviews on inflation, there are other problems mentioned, like monopole problem, why don't we see monopoles, gravitino problem. But these are all model dependent, right? You could say, okay, I have a theory which has no monopole and then the problem doesn't arise, or I don't believe in supergravity, so period. But here I wanted to focus on two problems which are, in my opinion, rather generic. And what amazes me, that's why I worked on inflation, that's why they struck to me, they are completely unrelated problems, but they originate from the same issue, from the fact that conventional sources lead to decelerated expansion. Okay?
Somebody is asking what you mean by sources.
Okay, sorry, sources, yes. When we wrote the Freeman equation, here, it's like, you know, Einstein theory. There is a curvature. This is just the expansion of the universe, which is related to energy, right? You need to put something that drives the expansion of the universe. By source, I mean the quantity that drives the expansion of the universe. And here you see I am parametrizing sources in the simplest way, as we do typically in cosmology, with some perfect fluids, which of course is just a parametrization which works nicely on large scales. So this would be like matter, or is just like radiation. So by conventional source, I mean sources of energy density that are conventional in nature. For example, could be neutrinos, photons, baryons, these things I mean. Yeah, thanks for telling me if there are questions because I'm not able.
There was another question which was answered in the chat, but maybe for those who are present. The question was, when you say it's 0.4%, is 0.4% of what?
Of the total. So if today I take this number and I divide by this number, that's essentially what it has to be. So this has to be for 0.4% relative to the total budget. Thank you. Yes?
So for the horizon problem, all the problem is because the CMB temperature is one value. So can it explain the fluctuation on the temperature?
Can
it explain the fluctuations on
We will discuss the fluctuations in a moment, but before you discuss about small things, we discuss about big things, right? The question, you're very important, what you ask, and I will be very important part of my discussion, how we generate the perturbations. But right now, the zeroth order question is not even that, right? Why is the temperature the same? And of course, you could argue it's the same because it's the same, right? It's an issue of initial conditions. And you can never disprove that this was just there. But I'm trying to appeal to our thinking, right, that if things never be in causal connection, why should the initial conditions be prepared so that they are really equal? You could, like the flatness problem, you could always argue it's an initial condition problem, things are what it is. But we are trying to make sense of these initial conditions.
Is there a conservation law that forbids k to verify?
No, this is parametrized. In a way, the curvature term is a scales as 1 over a square, and we parametrize this to be either 0 plus 1 or minus 1. If there is no A, I don't want to enter in this. It's a question of normalization. The curvature term goes down. If you just work out the Einstein equation, this term works down as 1 over A squared. And we normalize it so that this is a constant number, 0, 1, or minus 1, for the universe flat, closed, or open. They're just topologically distinct. So a universe cannot transit from one to the other in the classical evolution. Maybe that's actually probably what you asked. Yeah. Okay?
One more question from the chat. So they're asking, why don't you include dark energy or CC in among the sources?
I'm about to include dark energy. The point is that the current, the current dark energy is very tiny, and it was relevant, is relevant only for very recent amount of cosmology. If I just look at early universe, the current dark energy is completely irrelevant. But what I will do, I will try now to include something that looks like dark energy. So now inflation these problems are solved if universe underwent a period of accelerated expansion. This must have happened before BBN. So for time smaller at least than 1 second. So if we understand that the problems are due to the decelerated expansion, let's introduce a period of accelerated expansion. Of course, we don't have evidence for this, starting from the formation of light nuclei, because we observed the remnants of the light nuclei formed when the universe started to be 1 second old. And we know that the expansion was conventional from that point on, so was decelerated, apart from this very last stage of dark energy domination. So this early acceleration must have occurred within the first second. Probably much earlier than that, but at least within the first second. So during inflation, a single causally connected region blows up to cover all the sky we see today. So there is an accelerated expansion, and then the single region blows up to cover all the sky we see today. It's the reverse of what happens in decelerated expansion. And then this extra source, which let's for a moment call it for a second rho x, decreases less than the curvature. Remember, the curvature was decreasing as 1 over a squared. But this source that we put, since we want to have accelerated expansion, decreases less than the curvature term. So this drives the curvature term to be negligible. And then, eventually, this source S decays in matter and radiation. So the idea is that you have this source, which is less diluted by the expansion. It wins over the curvature term. And then, eventually, it will decay into matter and radiation. So loosely speaking, we say this source flattens the universe. But in a sense, what it means that the curvature term becomes negligible with respect to this source. the source inflaton field. We know very little about what the inflaton field is, but we have no evidence for spin. So simply, typically, we take a scalar field. Although people have also considered higher spin fields, but in principle, there's nothing against just taking a scalar field, which is the simplest option. So the simplest acceleration, this is not what inflation is, but let me just discuss the simplest casing. Is from a cosmological constant. Or vacuum energy. Now, if you put in the equation that I was writing to you before, A dot square over A square is equal constant, then we all recognize, right, differential equation that is solved by exponential growth. And indeed, the solution is A, some initial value, e to the ht. This is what we call the Sitter universe. This is not inflation. Inflation is a departure from the Sitter. But this would be the simplest possible. Yes, please. Sorry? Yeah, I could take the negative solution. So I will start as initial condition H positive. Otherwise, yeah, mathematically I could do it, but because it's squared, the equation. Yeah. What we have, right? We have that this is an exponentially growing universe. The problem with this, there are a couple of problems. First of all, that if it is really the vacuum energy, that's it, right? Because the vacuum energy is the smallest energy configuration of the theory, which means that you're going to do inflation forever. Or you could even have the situation that this is a false energy, something like that. These were the original models of inflation. And then you have inflation, and then eventually you go away from inflation by tunneling. But the problem here is that tunneling doesn't occur everywhere in the universe. Tunneling occurs in separate regions, which are bubbles of true vacuum. But then the space between them is still the Sitter space. So essentially, you have regions which tunnel, but these regions get far apart from each other, even if each region expands. But the Sitter nature of the space in between makes these bubbles going far away from each other. And so you end up either living in the Sitter or living in an empty bubble, neither of which is our universe. So these models of the first realizations of inflation, which were thought to be of this type, are not successfully explaining the exit from inflation. And then, very cleverly, people understood, OK, we don't really need perfect expansion, exponential expansion. We don't need perfect vacuum energy. We just need something that behaves similarly to vacuum energy. So instead of having a potential where the energy is exactly constant, let's make it very flat so that it evolves very slowly. But it evolves so slowly that we can treat it almost as constant. So that's the type of potentials that we would kind of look. So here is this inflaton field. Here is the potential. We will look for potentials which are like this. So during inflation, you are here. And so you see that this is V of phi is nearly constant during inflation. We would say that the potential is flat. And you see, this mimics very nicely a vacuum energy. This thing evolves slowly. As long as you are in this region of the potential, you have like vacuum energy with this tiny departure from it. And then eventually, inflation ends here. So here, the potential is no longer flat. Inflation ends. So you see how economical it is, right? In a simple cartoon, in a simple model, you get everything. Eventually, the field will oscillate. And we are going to discuss in a moment later how, what is the behavior effectively when the field is oscillating. But eventually it will oscillate and decay. So in this picture, which is called the slow roll inflation, is the simplest picture of inflation that we have in mind today in concrete realizations of inflation. We define the slow roll parameters. Epsilon is essentially related to the first derivative of the potential. So prime means dv in d phi. Actually, prime means d in d phi. Okay? And you want the potential to be flat. And also, we require the second derivative of the potential to be small. Because essentially, you want it flat for sufficient delta phi. Imagine that the potential was flat, the first derivative is small, but then the second derivative is huge. Then the first derivative becomes small only for a tiny amount of field space. And this is not enough. We are going to discuss this in a moment. So you want the potential to be flat for a sufficiently wide range of inflaton values. And that essentially is controlled by these two slow roll parameters, and you require them to be much smaller than one. Yes?
What is causing the field to fade?
What caused the field?
To fade after rolls.
Very good, very good. So what will happen, we're going to discuss all this. The field is going to decrease for two reasons. First, because of the expansion of the universe. Mm-hmm. And second, because it decays. So we don't want it to be stable because we are not made out of inflatons. And so we want the inflaton to decay at some point.
And when it decays?
You and me. It decays in us. No, it's a very, you're asking the crucial point of a lot of activity. What does it decay into? It's very model dependent, and we're going to try to discuss this.
So basically, it decays to the plasma that we
see. Yeah, but it's not straightforward because it could decay in many different ways. It could be slow decay, fast decay. It could decay in something that then decays in something else. It's a completely complicated chain, which we don't really have under full control. It is a very open problem.
And during which time, how do we define the chemical potential at that of that decay time? Would we touch on that?
Depends whether we have conserved quantities or not when we speak about chemical potential. But we are going to discuss very little about thermalization. It's an open problem because it doesn't decay into a thermal bath. It decays, for example, imagine an inflaton that decays into particles. They both carry energy half the inflaton mass. It's not a thermal bath. Now, the question is very complicated. How do the daughter thermalize? It's a subject of open research. So it's really, what you're asking me is completely non-trivial, and I'm going to touch on it as much as we can. Okay? So far, I discussed only the background evolution, right? But it was already asked about perturbations. And it's actually a beautiful byproduct that just came out as a byproduct of this. It's a mechanism for primordial perturbations. It's already inside this model. You don't have to add anything else. The problem is it was hard to recognize, and it's really hard to recognize it at the calculational level. But that's it. You just take this model. This model in its own has already everything that we need to generate primordial perturbations. And you have to perturb. You will have perturbation of the inflaton field, perturbation of the metric. And you can ask yourself, imagine I have only one inflaton. How many degrees of freedom, how many physical degrees of freedom do I have? It's really remarkable. You have 1 degree of freedom in the inflaton, and then you have 10 degrees of freedom in the metric, right? Because the metric is a 4x4 object, which is symmetric. But they are not all physicals, right? For example, I can do change of coordinates, and remove some of these elements. I can do four change of coordinates, right? T, X, Y, Z. So 4 degrees of freedom are left. And then you can also see that 4 degrees of freedom enter without kinetic term, like the A0 term in electromagnetism. This would be the 0, 0, and 0i component of the metric. So there are 4 degrees of freedom that you write your theory, but they enter without kinetic term. So you remove 4. And if my math is OK, the result is 3. So there are 3 physical degrees of freedom in the model. And one of them is the density perturbation, which I call it zeta. It's what we call scalar perturbation. Because this is how it behaves on spatial rotations. It behaves as a scalar. And then there are 2 degrees of freedom left, which are the 2 polarization of the gravitational waves. Again, these names depend on how they transform when you do spatial rotations, for example. I will not go into too much math, because this really would take hours and hours. But I will. My point here is we will try to discuss the properties of these perturbations. So by just counting, we understand that there are 3 degrees of freedom. And these are already inside the model. And we now need to understand how to work out their properties. So the first thing that we need to do, we need to consider. So now we move to the, we finish the discussion of motivations of inflation. And we even mentioned the simplest model of inflation. So I'm going to be very quick on this, as you saw. And now I'm going to make a review about the properties of the primordial perturbations. And I want us to make a physical intuition about this, because I'm not going to be able to do all the full math, but I'm going to try to do some part of the math. So here I want to tell you to consider a perturbation in our sky. And trace it back during inflation. What I mean, I really mean, imagine your sky. And imagine you could see these density perturbations with your eyes. And you make Fourier decomposition. So this will be like waves in your sky. So there will be waves which have different wavelength. And this will be all you see, right? Imagine you could do with your eyes. You could see the density in the universe. You could see it with your eyes. And then you do a Fourier decomposition. So you see that there are essentially waves of density. What this would mean, that here there is more density, here there is less density. More density, less density. So that's what I really mean by just looking density mode all across of my sky. And then I can say these are, of course, this would be megaparsec, like a very huge wavelength. And I ask myself, OK, what did they do during inflation? How do I trace them back? And remember that essentially, this is just a question of how physical scales evolve during inflation. So here is time. Here is physical scales. And let me put inflation on negative times. So what I will have that the perturbation grows essentially, your inflation finishes nearly exponentially. This is the scale factor. Because the wavelength of the perturbation, like all physical scales, is proportional to the scale factor. Instead, the horizon, what we called horizon before, is h. This is nearly constant. In fact, you can think h to increase very slightly. Because remember the equation we wrote before, h squared was proportional to rho. If rho was exactly constant, h would be constant, the Sitter universe. But you see, the energy is slightly decreasing, because this guy moves very slowly, but it moves. So h to the minus 1 is slightly increasing. This would be my horizon. But essentially, I draw it nearly constant. And now I can see, so this will be h to the minus 1. And now I can see that there are 3 regimes in this plot. So there is regime number 1, regime number 2, and regime number 3. regime number one is what we call sub-horizon. And what you would have, if this is your horizon, you have a wavelength which is like this. So lambda is much smaller than h. And what you have here, you have that this is like Minkowski. So the perturbations behaves similarly to flat space time. Because essentially the perturbation oscillates on a scale which is given by its momentum. And you see the momentum of the oscillation is much faster than the scale h to the minus 1. So this perturbation essentially doesn't even notice that it's on an expanding background. It's true that lambda of this perturbation is a constant times the scale factor, but this grows slowly because this quantity is slowly with respect to the time scale of the oscillation of the perturbation. So the perturbation here is like a quantum oscillator. It's like a quantum perturbation that is oscillating, minding its own business. This is the regime one. The regime three is a super horizon. And here is essentially the horizon. And here is what the perturbation does. Because this perturbation, the wavelength, is much greater than the horizon. And if you have only one field, essentially this field doesn't even realize that it exists. And essentially this is just frozen due to causality. Because essentially it's too large a scale to even notice its own existence, in a sense. It's just frozen there. Instead, what you see, the interesting moment, is when the field is comparable. The wavelength is comparable to the horizon. This is the regime two. And here is when the geometry imprints the mode. So you ask yourself, during the evolution of inflation, when did the expansion had the chance to do something on the mode? It had not the chance to do anything here. Here it only makes the wavelength increase, but it's like us, essentially. We live on time scales which are much greater than the Hubble scale. If you do experiments here, you never notice that the universe is expanding, just because it's expanding way too slowly compared to our motions, essentially. So in this case, the perturbation doesn't care about the expansion of the universe. In this case, essentially, the perturbation is sleeping. The only moment that you get something is at this moment here. And so we understand that the perturbations, by studying the perturbation, we can get information of the universe at the time in which the perturbation was leaving the horizon. And now you can imagine having two different perturbations in our sky. So let me just take this perturbation. Let me call it lambda 1. And then take, so this will be lambda 1. So let me forget this. And then take another perturbation, lambda 2, in our sky, which is bigger. This perturbation will be bigger on this axis. So you see that the perturbation bigger leaves the horizon, exits the horizon earlier than this. So lambda 2 is essentially produced earlier. So it probes earlier stage of inflation. You understand that there will be some moment which we can no longer see, because perturbations that are extremely huge, so that they are bigger than our sky, they were produced in this moment of time, but we don't have access to this. So we don't know these modes. We don't see them because they are just constant on our Hubble patch. And so we cannot make any direct observation of what the universe was doing at that time. Also, if the perturbation is too small today, it's not cosmological, it's not in the linear regime anymore, we also don't get information on this perturbation. And so the duration of inflation that we can directly probe is rather limited. I will be more quantitative later on. But in a sense, the crucial point here is that if you see different perturbations in our sky, the bigger the wavelength, the earlier the perturbation was produced. So the earlier time of inflation, you can directly probe by studying the properties of that perturbation. Questions? OK. Now, one thing I also want to say, and this will be crucial in what I'm about to discuss, is that the departure from the sitter due to epsilon and eta different from zero, right? Remember, let me define them once again. We know that they are much smaller than one. In a moment, I will tell you more quantitatively why they are much smaller than one. We know that they are much smaller than one, but we know they are not zero. If they were zero, we would be the sitter universe, right? Potential exactly constant. But there is a tiny departure from the sitter. But this tiny departure, although it's very tiny, is crucial from what I'm about to discuss. And I want to discuss three properties of the primordial perturbations. And I will ascribe all of them to due to the small deviation from the sitter. So the first one property is a near scale invariance. So let me again make the same cartoon of the potential that I was doing before. And the statement is that modes of different size have nearly the same power. These are properties of the primordial perturbation that we observe by measurements. But these are also predictions of slow roll inflation, essentially. So it's remarkable that slow roll inflation predicts properties of perturbations which are in very good agreement with what we observe. And we parameterize this dependence. So zeta is this delta rho over rho that I was telling you. We compute the power spectrum. And the power spectrum, in general, will depend on some power of the wavelength. And the prediction of inflation is 1 minus ns is 6 epsilon minus 2 eta. So what you see right from this prediction, if epsilon and eta were zero, you would get exact scale invariance. So you would have modes where the power is the same at different scales. So concretely, what do I mean? I mean, if you take perturbation like this in your sky, then you take perturbation like this in your sky, then you take perturbation like this in your sky, remarkably, they were all originated with the same power. And that essentially is one of the predictions of slow roll inflation. And these modes don't know anything one of the, to the other. So there's certainly something that makes them generated with kind of the same power. And we understand that this is due to departure from small departure from the sitter. Because remember the cartoon I was telling you before, where I was telling you, right, this is the horizon, nearly constant. This is perturbation number one, and this is perturbation number two. So this is lambda one, lambda two, and we take lambda two greater than lambda one. So lambda 2 was produced at this moment in time. Say that at this moment in time, the inflaton was here. Lambda 1 was produced later. So let's call with the star this moment. The inflaton maybe was here. But as you can see, as a consequence of the slow roll, the universe at this moment is essentially the same as the universe at this moment. So the second perturbation nearly sees the same universe as the first perturbation. Not exactly the same, because you see the potential has slightly changed, but nearly the same. This is the reason why they are generating with nearly the same power. Because the second almost sees the same condition as the first one, just does it later, but it goes over the same process. So you have nearly scale invariance because you have nearly time symmetry during inflation. It's broken, it's not perfect, but you see there is a near time translation symmetry. As a consequence that is broken only very little, deviation from scale invariant are only very small.
Mark.
Just let me finish the sentence, then I'll take the question. And you can see from the calculation, indeed you find that NS is equal 1, right, would be scale invariant, that's how it is parametrized. There is not exactly 1, but is something proportional to the slow roll parameters. Yes?
So they are asking about the definition of power.
I will discuss it later. I will discuss it later. You can just say, for example, just take the field squared, take this integral, and then you can define it as dk over k power of k. That's one possible definition. You just take a perturbation that has zero average, and you compute the variance. And the variance, when you go to momentum space, is the logarithmic integral of the power spectrum. That's a way to define it.
Also do this in detail in my second lecture.
Okay, this will also be done tomorrow then in the lectures. Yeah, we will be more quantitative on this. Just take a perturbation, right? The perturbation has a mean zero. So what you will do, you will look at the two-point function of the perturbation to understand how much power there is. And the two-point function of perturbation is related to the integral of the power spectrum. If you want, you can also show that this is k cubed over 2 pi squared, the perturbation in momentum space. I will actually go over it later on in my lectures. Other questions? Yes, please.
What about the other sources? Like, they will change between those two moments?
Which other sources?
Radiation.
Very good question. Anything else that is there gets immediately blown away, and we don't care about it. Because we need to discuss this. It will be part also of things that I'm going to do later. You can ask yourself, how much did the universe need to expand during inflation? And typically, we would need something like e to the 60. So this is like 10 to the 30. So the universe expands by a huge factor, and the volume, for example, is like 10 to the 90. So any other source will just get diluted away. So it's irrelevant. There could be other scalar fields, and this would give a different type of phenomenology, like isocurvature perturbations. So if there are other scalar fields, you could have much more richer phenomenology. Here I'm discussing only the simplest one. But conventional sources, they just get diluted away. Yes?
One more question. So it's about the dependence of lambda on the scale factor, the wavelength.
Yes, so lambda, right? Let's just take a class on just basic mechanics. You define the wave number, and lambda is 2 pi over k. This is just a generic wave. So this is the wavelength, this is the wave number, just a wave. But now the universe is expanding, so due to the expansion of the universe, we usually put it here. So this is called comoving wavelength, without factoring in the expansion of the universe. But when you factor in the expansion of the universe, I'm just saying that a physical scale, like a wavelength, grows proportionally to the scale factor. This is also called comoving momentum, like the comoving units were defined this morning, right? If imagine you scale out the expansion of the universe, you make a grid, but the expansion of the universe adds this to the physical distances. Okay, so this is one property, just due to scale invariance, nearly scale invariance. And then there is another property, a bit more complicated to describe, but also due to nearly scale invariance. the fact that the gravitational waves have a power much smaller than the density perturbations. So the power in gravitational waves is smaller than the power in the density perturbations. Yes, please.
In which those perturbations are located? I mean, those are the density perturbations, but you said that there is only scalar perturbation, that everything else is diluted.
Yes.
So in which way you can see those perturbations?
The field that carries energy, so you can think about the energy density of that field. Eventually, that field decays. So if you have a region where the field was slightly more energetic, it will have more energy when the field decays. These regions, for example, will be higher temperature, greater temperature in the CMB, for example. So when we look at the CMB map, it's a consequence of the primordial perturbations. Yes. In the theory of inflation, right, that's all there is. And that's also where we can tell the magnitude. Because when you look at CMB perturbations, they are at the level of 10 to the minus 5. So we know that these things we are talking about are small quantities.
So this evolution is local, right?
Absolutely. It's actually what I'm about to draw in a moment. So if you just give me a second, I will be just answering to your thing.
But precisely, we are not sure about the decay process.
We are not sure about anything, right? So I'm telling you the theory as currently we think about it. No, but it will conserve energy in a local sense, right? So if I have a region where there is more energy, when it decays, there will be remaining more energy in that region. Then it may be spread, but on a time scale, on a very quick time scale, you just have local conservation of energy.
My question is still the inflator, will decay for photons, will decay for any other particles?
It will decay. We are going to discuss this, but I'm going to tell you we don't know. But it just decays, right? It doesn't really matter if it decays into photons or electrons, for example, because they would immediately, I don't know how much, but they would thermalize and form a thermal bath. So as long as it decays in something visible, then these things are going to create the thermal bath.
Yeah, but I understand that the particles were not created up to this point.
There was just the inflaton. The inflaton decays. It's a very good constraint, because imagine you have a theory with many hidden sectors. We need to explain why our sector got much more populated than something else, because we know that the degrees of freedom in invisible stuff need to be much smaller than the degrees of freedom in the visible sector. So this is absolutely non-trivial. How comes that we are dominant? We, in a sense, the dark matter, actually, but let me say extra sectors are much less populated, for example. This is a constraint that we need to realize in concrete models. But we don't have, right? You see, these are energy scales, probably so high that we don't have direct access to it. That contributes to our uncertainties. Yes?
Are you going to discuss, I mean, how these angular brackets are like quantum averages?
Yes. I'm going to be a little bit more, okay. But maybe we can be more. I'll try to do a little bit. Yes, but eventually we believe that the origin is the quantum nature of this that then becomes classical. So they are classical stochastic variables. Yeah. The origin is not unknown, but conventionally we would imagine that they have quantum origin, and then by some really not obvious thing, they become classical. They lose the quantum uncertainty, so we treat them as stochastic classical variables. Okay?
Excuse me.
Yes.
Could you repeat the questions when they ask them in person? Because we cannot hear them here on Zoom, so we don't know what they're saying. Also, there are a lot of questions in the chat that are not being looked at. So,
if we have discussion, maybe we can have the discussion session afterwards. So, because I would like to at least finish these arguments, and then maybe I'm very happy to answer questions, but maybe we can take the bulk of the questions in the discussion. Because I want to finish at least this part of the lecture to have a self-contained discussion. And this actually is something I care about a lot, and I would like to mention it. So here is what's going on, at least how I understand it. So here, let's say, just take a potential like this for simplicity. And we parameterize the ratio of the powers with this quantity here. And the prediction of inflation is 16 epsilon. So you see, this would be much smaller than 1 or smaller than 1. So the prediction of inflation is that you produce less power in gravitational waves than in the density perturbations. Now, how do we see this? The inflaton is a clock. Measuring the time to the end of inflation. It's actually the only really, the most sensible definition of time quantity that you could make. The inflaton, you can treat it as a clock. So what it means, right, if you know that inflation ends here, here you will have phi of t, and you can use the inflaton to tell what time it is, right? Because if the inflaton is higher, it will need more time. If the inflaton is lower, it will need less time. Now, this phi dot controls, remember, dot is time derivative. The classical evolution of the inflaton is the classical clock. Just it evolves classically according to its own equation. It's just the classical evolution of the clock. On the top of it, there are inflaton perturbations, which are perturbations of the clock, essentially. And these perturbations, essentially, tell me they are local, as we were discussing before, so local in space. There will be a region in space where the inflaton is slightly higher, which means that the clock is earlier there. And there will be regions in space which are slightly lower, which means that the clock is slightly more advanced, because in those regions, inflation will end up sooner. And now you can see that what really matters, essentially what it matters is that the slower the inflaton goes, the slower the classical inflaton. The more relevant the perturbations of the clock are. I'm understanding that I'm a bit quick here. I don't really want to go into the mathematical details, but I want to convey you the concept. The perturbations of the inflaton, they get generated with amplitude of order h. But what is relevant, remember, is something like delta rho over rho. It's never the amount of perturbation itself. It's the energy in the perturbation compared to the energy in the background. And or you can think about, in terms of clock, delta t over t. And if you have a clock that goes slower at the classical level, a perturbation of the type delta phi, it will be more important. The slower the background clock goes, the bigger will be the effect of the perturbation of the clock. And so, in a sense, the power spectrum on zeta, you can show that is proportional as 1 over epsilon, this Laurel parameter. That indicates to me that the slower the background clock goes, the bigger is the effect of the perturbation delta phi. This is not the same for gravitational waves. Gravitational waves don't know about this. They only care about the expansion of the universe. So gravitational waves, essentially, they are always, the power in gravitational wave is always proportional to h squared. It doesn't care about the background clock. So it's essentially what's important in my discussion is proportional to epsilon to the zero. So it's not proportional to epsilon. Because the flatness of the potential is irrelevant for the gravitational waves, only the amplitude of the because the gravitational waves only measure how fast the background is evolving. So when you do this ratio, you'll get something that is a number divided by a number over epsilon. So this is a number times epsilon, which is much smaller than 1. So it's something that a bit annoys me when I hear we haven't proved inflation because we haven't observed gravitational waves yet. It's a statement that many times you see. But in reality, one of the predictions of inflation, of slow roll inflation, is that gravitational waves are less than the density perturbations. We don't know what this number epsilon is. So we actually don't know, that, okay, this is 16 epsilon. We don't know the value of R. That's something that we are after with experiments. But there is nothing wrong with inflation if this epsilon is small. So there is nothing wrong with inflation if, unfortunately, we will not see these gravitational waves. Let me mention one final property, and then actually, I wanted to show you the slides just to give you how do we then look at this from primordial perturbations. And here is, well, yeah. View full. I don't see. Okay, so now you can see exactly the data taken from well, Planck plus combination of other. Is this the pointer?
Yes, try it. Should the point it to.
Is it not in zoom?
Okay, let me try maybe to to read it without pointing.
Non so come.
Oh. You need to press this one. Yeah. Okay, so these are just the experimental data. And you can see, right, the variables I'm telling you, R and NS. And these are actually the theoretical prediction. And zeta we have observed, because from the density in the CMB perturbations, you see the amplitude of the CMB perturbation. So we know what is delta rho over rho. And so the number that we know, that we have measured, is this quantity here. And you see that within inflation, this number is h squared divided by epsilon, this epsilon that I was telling you. So you see that this number, unfortunately, is not proportional to the scale of inflation. Because remember that epsilon squared is proportional to rho. And then this is the scale of inflation. But this we have not measured, because what we have measured is h squared divided by epsilon. And so only when we will measure the gravitational waves, we will measure the scale of inflation. So now the scale of inflation and the Abbot rate during inflation, they are parametrized in terms of this unknown quantity, because when we know the gravitational waves, the stochastic gravitational wave, we will know the value of R, and only then we will know the scale of inflation. So actually, this is something that still is unknown, so one of the many things that we don't know. And however, you can see how the experiments are telling us that these quantities here are of the order of 10 to the minus 2, as you can see here, at least. What am I doing with time? I'm done, so I will stop here for today. Thank you.
Okay, since the discussion session is right after this, maybe we can keep the questions for them and go for a half an hour break. Thank you.
Thank you.